If I haven't met you before, my name is Dom. I'm one of the leaders here with Adam and Bob, who unfortunately is unwell today, so you might like to keep him in your prayers as well. But it's great you're here. Welcome if this is your first time as well. It's very special to have you along here. Well, no matter where you travel around the world, and I know many here have travelled, one thing is universal. No matter which country you're living in, no matter which country you've come from, no matter which country you might have a holiday in, if you can do that in these times, that is, the universal truth is you wait a lot. And I'm waiting for the clicker. Someone got the clicker, please. Thank you. So you wait a lot. Just what you do in life is you just happen to wait. Thank you, Adam. I didn't have to wait long there. But sometimes you have to wait for a while. So let me give you a few examples. So in Singapore, it's a national pastime that you wait in queues for good food at hawker centres. And you learn from an early age to wait. And you've got to line up in neat little lines. If you happen to come from Malaysia, well, you learn to wait as you cross the border at JB to get into Singapore so you can wait some more in Singapore. I have missionary friends, Leslie and I have missionary friends in Africa. They wait a long time sometimes for their electricity and their water or their internet to come back on. Maybe you've experienced that yourself when you've travelled. In New Zealand, of course, you wait a lot for sheep in the way. Claire in the Middle East, our mission partner, she waits a lot for the Muslim fast to finish so then she can eat slow and tell her Muslim friends about the Lord Jesus through gospel stories. In Australia, of course, you wait a lot as well. You might wait at the Temple of IKEA after COVID lockdowns happened. You might wait a long time for government services. For those of you, if you applied for PR, you know what that's like. You might feel like that skeleton there just waiting around. And of course, at GBC, you even wait here for the best coffee on a Sunday morning at Harrison School. That's a guarantee because we got a monopoly on the coffee at Harrison School. But you wait. Across the globe, you see, people wait. Across God's kingdom or God's family, or across the Bible, God's people wait. God's people have always been a waiting people. Think about it. If you know the Bible at all, you know the stories from Abraham to Malachi, the Italian prophet, as I like to call him, or Malachi, if you like. God's people have been waiting for the arrival of the serpent head-crushing Messiah. They wait a long time. And then Joseph and Mary, of course, they have to wait 9 months, the usual 9 months, for the arrival of God's anointed king. John the Baptist, or Jack the Dipper, as I like to call him, he waits in the desert for his son to take, to take over from his preaching ministry and to preach the kingdom of God is here. The disciples then wait after the resurrection. There they are, waiting in the upper room for the divine helper who will equip and empower them to take this gospel message to the ends of the earth, beyond the borders of ancient Israel. And then in the book of Revelation, we find that even the saints in heaven, they are waiting. They're crying out, "How long, O Lord, until the end comes? How long, O Lord, until your glory is revealed?" God's people are waiting. God's people have always been a waiting people. And now, like the first century church plant in Thessalonica, the 21st century church plant in Gungahlin, we too are a people who wait. We are now a waiting people. We're now a looking forward people, waiting for the arrival of God's Son, the return of the Lord Jesus, the parousia, the apocalypse, his epiphany. And in a culture of instant gratification and instant food, and instant spending, and Instagram, waiting, this waiting period, you might find somewhat difficult. Waiting for this pandemic to go away. Waiting for petrol prices to go down. We might be waiting a long time. Waiting for winter to end sometime soon in the next couple of months. Bob, Rick and I at this church, we're waiting a long time for St. George to win a rugby league premiership. We'll be waiting a long time. Some of you wait a long time for babies to be born. Some of you wait a long time to fall pregnant or to rise pregnant. I read an intriguing article by an Australian psychiatrist. It was titled "Instant Gratification is a Toxin Poisoning Our Children." That was the title of it by a psychiatrist. It's no surprise when you give 10-year-olds a mobile phone or an iPad or a TV remote. Instant gratification. In 2022, we all find waiting difficult. But as God's people, we've always been a waiting people. Waiting on a God who has made promises in the Bible for centuries and has proven faithful to each and every one of those promises. And now, like the Thessalonians in chapter 1, verse 10, we're called to wait patiently for the arrival of God's Son. Some of you have been waiting a long time for this series in 1 Thessalonians to end. Well, today it does. After 10 weeks, some of you might remember, I know not everyone has been with us here, but 10 weeks ago we started this journey with this big picture overview of this often neglected part of the New Testament, this letter in 1 Thessalonians. And I introduced us to these big themes of geography and history and Paulology and churchology and eschatology, the study of the last times, the end days, and Christology, the study of the Lord Jesus. I hope if you've been part of this church, I hope you benefited from this part of God's Word, as I have personally in my study. I hope you benefit not from a head full of knowledge, though that does come as you learn and grow as a Christian, but rather with a heart shaped by God's will and by God's ways, a life that seeks to grow in holiness, a life that seeks to be a role model of living the Christian life. Remember the church in Thessalonica, it's held up as this role model church in the first century to be people who are walking to please God, to be people who cooperate with the Holy Spirit living inside us. I hope you want to be part of a church that turns its back on expressive individualism and embraces the family nature of being part of God's kingdom, God's family. And now it's my privilege not only to preach this series, but to close this series with a few short verses right at the end of chapter 5. I've packaged it under the theme of waiting. We are to be a role model of waiting, of people waiting. And I've also left inside your bulletins a little card for you to do sometime this week. I hope you take the opportunity, especially if you've been journeying with us here at GBC, to reflect on this part of God's Word together. But before we go any further, let's pause and pray again and ask for God's help this morning. Heavenly Father, you are the God of peace. So would you please sanctify us, body, soul, and spirit this morning. And please, in your kindness, bring us to maturity, and please find us ready for the coming of the Lord Jesus. Help us now this morning to hear you speak clearly and to be people who are obedient to your word. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please open your Bibles to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, starting at verse 12. And a dear sister of a girl who has the best name in church, she's going to read the Bible to us. Darnell, hopefully she has a microphone.
Yes.
You can work out who her sister is later on if you don't know her. So Darnell's going to read, starting at verse 12 through to 28. So please open chapter 5 up, 1 Thessalonians. Please take it away, Darnell. Thank you.
Verse 12, we ask you, brothers, to respect those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love because of their work. Be at peace among yourselves. And we urge you, brothers, admonish the idle, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, be patient with them all. See that no one repays anyone evil for evil, but always seek to do good to one another and to everyone. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not despise prophecies, but test everything. Hold fast what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, And may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it. Brothers, pray for us. Greet all the brothers with a holy kiss. I put you under oath before the Lord to have this letter read to all the brothers. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
Thank you very much. Now remember, brothers and sisters, even though ESV just translates it brothers, brothers and sisters. Well, Jack showed us last week from chapter 5, verses 12 to 18, a model for a growing church. You might remember he took us from lavender seeds to GBC, maturing in our relationships with one another and with God. So the sort of horizontal and the vertical, as I like to think about it, the cross-shaped relationships are what we are to be on about. Now we continue to think about our relationship with God and with one another in these verses here. I'm going to pick it up where Jack left off, and we're going to go from verse 19 through to the end of the book, or the end of the letter, to verse 28. Look at verse 19. While we wait for his son to come from heaven, do not quench the Spirit. Or your translation might say, do not stifle the Holy Spirit, or don't dampen the Spirit's fire. Now, we're not told more than that by the Apostle Paul. So what does he mean, do not quench the Spirit? Well, he can't mean that as Christians, if you're a Christian here today, you've taken part in the Lord's Supper, he can't mean that we lose access to the Holy Spirit, that somehow the Holy Spirit departs from you and me as Christians. If you're truly a follower of the Lord Jesus, the Holy Spirit does not come and go depending on how you're traveling in holiness or obedience. The Holy Spirit doesn't come or go depending on whether you had a 55-minute quiet time or a 5-minute quiet time where 4 of those minutes were spent making coffee. And you think that's a 5-minute quiet time. Now, the Holy Spirit doesn't go depending on how you're traveling in obedience. In order to follow what Paul means here, we need to understand a little bit about the New Testament teaching on the Holy Spirit. And that is, the Holy Spirit is a person. A he, not an it. A who, not a what. He's a person, not a force like in Star Wars or the New Age movement. As a third person in the Trinity, and that'll blow your mind on a Sunday morning, won't it? As a third person in the Trinity, in the Bible, he is often represented with the metaphor or the image of fire. And he can be grieved. The Holy Spirit can be hurt. You can cause him sorrow. Think about it. You can't grieve a force any more than you can upset or grieve a rock. You can't grieve the periodic table of elements or the wind or gravity, but you can grieve, you can hurt, you can resist the Spirit of God. You can quench the fire of the Holy Spirit. How? Well, the New Testament highlights a few ways, and I've summarized on the screen some of the things that the New Testament talks about. This is how you can quench the Spirit, dampen the Spirit. So ongoing unrepentant sin in your life, immorality in the believer's life, idleness or just sheer laziness as a Christian in the Christian life, making dumb choices that go against God's clearly revealed will. You'll quench the Spirit. Hearing God's word but hardening your heart against it. Staying out of regular Christian fellowship will most certainly dampen or quench the fire of the Spirit. Willfully breaking God's commandments. See, all these things, straying from how God wants us to live, to be Christ-like, will quench or dampen the Spirit's work in your life, causing a loss of spiritual joy, vitality, causing a loss of spiritual power to live the Christian life. Brothers and sisters, if you're a follower of the Lord Jesus here today, examine your own life, as I need to do for me, and make sure you're not hindering the Holy Spirit's work in your life, which, as this letter has shown us, is really to grow us in sanctification, that is to grow us more in holiness this side of eternity, to make us more and more like the Lord Jesus, to walk in God's will. In 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 6, Paul tells Timothy to fan into flame the gift of the Holy Spirit. Well, here it seems almost the opposite. It appears you can fan out of flame the gift of the Holy Spirit, or the power of the Holy Spirit at work. Remember, it takes the Word of God by the Spirit of God to do the work of God in the people of God. So do not dampen that work of God that he's doing in your life and mine. Then in verse 20, we're told, comes another command rather, and it's related to this. And again, it's to do with our relationship with God. Look what it says, verse 20, do not despise prophecy. Or the NIV, if you've got an NIV in front of you, say, do not treat prophecy with contempt. What's this all about? Well, first we need to define prophecy to see if we're despising it. Slight problem, however, the New Testament writers never define prophecy for us in this new covenant era, in these last days that we're living. We do know that the Old Testament prophets, they speak and they write God's word to us. And so we've got books like Isaiah and Jeremiah and all the other Iahs and Daniel and Amos and Elijah and Moses. They're all called prophets. And their words, whether they speak or they write, their words carry great authority, great weight of Holy Scripture, the weight of God himself speaking. We also know the apostles then come along, Peter, Paul, James, John, and the others. They play an equivalent role so that when they write their New Testament books and letters, they're actually on the same level as Old Testament writings. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13, you might remember that verse we looked at a few weeks ago. They write the word of God, not the word of man, not the word of people. But then the New Testament prophet comes along after the apostles, and they're not in the same category as the Old Testament and the New Testament writers. So in the book of Acts, we have prophets called Silas and Agabus and Philip, who has four daughters who are prophetesses. I've only got three daughters, so Philip's in a different category than me. But they're all called prophets and prophetesses. There are prophets in the church at Rome, prophets in the church in Antioch, in Jerusalem. The churches of Asia Minor have prophets, we're told. There are many New Testament gift lists that talk about prophecy. In fact, even 1 Corinthians chapter 4 talks about eagerly desiring this gift of prophecy. But we also know that prophecy is different from preaching. In the New Testament, women can prophesy in the public gathering of God's people, of the saints, but only qualified men are given authority to preach. James chapter 3, verse 1, preaching carries with it great responsibility, much more than prophecy ever does. False prophecy in a church, you can ignore that. False preaching in a church, expel the person from the church, the New Testament speaks in those categories. So it's not so simplistic as some people say, well, prophecy is just like preaching. Clearly that's not the case as you read through the New Testament. So where do we end up with do not despise prophecy? Well, in humility, we do need to acknowledge that it's not so black and white. It's not so easily defined for us by the New Testament. So we need to be very careful about statements that we make. But here's two definitions that over my Christian journey, I keep coming back to. I found these very helpful by two humble servants who have bigger brains than I do. They're called theologians. And here on the screen are their definitions. One by a guy called Michael Green, who's an Englishman, and Wayne Grudem, who's an American Pentecostal. One a conservative, an evangelical, one would be in the Pentecostal camp. Michael Green writes, prophecy is neither bizarre nor ecstatic. It is a perfectly intelligible word from the Lord through a member of his body inspired by his spirit and is given to build up the rest of the body. It's a message that the speaker does not make up. It is born in upon him or her. They speak it out. it is an act of faith. Wayne Grudem summarizes like this: prophecy is a reception and subsequent transmission of spontaneous, divinely originating revelation. I found both those definitions helpful. Maybe you do, maybe you don't. Prophecy, under these terms, or thinking about this, is not the same as the Word of God. It's not the same as the Bible. That is, it's not new words from God. Perhaps Wayne Grudem there mentioning the word revelation can be misleading, and maybe there's a better word you could use, but it's not talking about the same level as the Bible. It's not new words from God. We have 66 books. That's enough, God says. I think it's more the application of God's word to a specific time, to a specific people and place. That's how I like to think of prophecy as I sort of grapple with what is the New Testament talking about here. So here's some examples. I think these people today have the gift of prophecy. So people like Tim Keller, if you know any of his writings, American pastor. Philip Jensen, if you know of his ministry in Sydney. I think it's very prophetic in lots of ways. Steve McAlpine, I've shared some of his articles as he writes. Tim Challies, an American blogger. Rebecca McLaughlin is a great American author, though she's English. She's living in America. She's an American theologian. Last century, maybe it was people like John Stott or Francis Schaeffer or C.S. Lewis or A.W. Tozer, if you know any of these people. That's why they write good books, whereas I write average sermons. A big difference there. They're sort of engaging with people who have a gift, I think, of reading the culture, the society, the church around us, and then uniquely applying God's word to that situation. Yes, elements of preaching can do that, but prophecy, I think, is, again, different than teaching and preaching God's word. You might have your own thoughts on that, but that's how I've sort of grappled with this concept, this gift of prophecy in the New Testament church. So with that bit of background in mind, we're told, do not despise prophecy. So by application, I think don't reject things too quickly, but remain open to God's Spirit at work, especially if someone gives you a word of wisdom, some godly advice. Don't outrightly reject that. Don't outrightly reject godly counsel from someone, because it could well be a word from God to build you up, to rebuke you, to admonish you. Remember verse 12 and 13 last week. It could well be, if someone gives you and says, oh, I want to share something with you, it could well be a word from God, not at the same level as God's word, but a word from God nonetheless, to grow you in godliness. But in saying all this, Paul's next command in verse 21a is crucial. Look at verse 21a. But test everything. In other words, any such prophecy must be weighed up. This is a consistent theme across the New Testament. Here on the screen, I'll show you what I mean. Now, this verse, test the prophecy, hold fast to what is good. 1 John 4, verses 1 to 6, test the spirits, be aware of false prophets. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 10, one of the gifts given to God's people is the ability to distinguish between spirits. There are evil spirits, there are good spirits. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 10, discern what is pleasing to the Lord. Test everything. And 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, so the second letter Paul writes, chapter 2 verses 1 to 2, is very helpful, I think, in getting our heads around this. He writes, concerning the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered to him, we ask you, brothers and sisters, not to become easily unsettled or alarmed by the teaching allegedly from us, whether by a prophecy or by a word of mouth or by a letter asserting that the day of the Lord has already come. Can you see what's happening there? He's saying, test everything. Doesn't matter if people are even writing in our name, if they're writing, signing letters by the Apostle Paul, test everything. I like the illustration that Charles Spurgeon, is a great preacher from yesteryear, he gives on testing someone's teaching or prophecy. He likens it to a joint of meat or a hunk of meat gone bad, and you can smell that it's off straight away. You might open someone's fridge. Maybe you go to Jack and Wei Shen and Jack's apartment. You open their fridge and you go, "There's something off here," and there's a bit of meat down the back corner. It's highly unlikely if you know these guys, but here's what Charles Spurgeon says. Some people seem to think that they must read a bad book through and they must go and hear a bad preacher often before they can be sure of his quality. Why, you can judge many teachings in 5 minutes. You say to yourself, "No, sir, no, 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 no. This is good meat for dogs. Let them have it. But it's not good meat for me, and I do not intend to poison myself." It's typical Spurgeon, if you know any of his writings. If someone claims to be a prophet, if someone claims to even give you a prophecy or a word from God, there's some basic tests that you can apply, and you can do it with a series of questions. I've summarized them into 7 questions, because 7's a great number. It's God's number. Here it is. Here's the very first question you've got to ask, the most important. Does it line up with Scripture? What they're saying, does it line up with Scripture? If it's not there in the Bible, then walk away or laugh at them. Have nothing to do with it. Does it line up with Scripture? Second question, does it glorify God and point me to Jesus? Or rather, is it pointing them to them, the speaker, or to the church, or to the individual? No, it needs to point to Jesus, to glorify God. Third question, does this so-called word of prophecy build up the church? Does it build up the individual? Is it spoken in love? Fourthly, is the person prophesying in control of themselves? Is it an understandable word? Or to use Michael Green's word, is it an intelligible word? It's no good speaking Swahili to me and saying this is a word from God. That doesn't cut it. Fifth question, who is this person? Can they be trusted? That's very important. Sixth question, is it on about the main things of Scripture rather than some obscure sort of strange passage in the Bible? Is it on about the main thing? And final question, does it point me to the gospel of grace, or is it leading me down this dead end path of legalism or just try harder Christianity? Keep those questions in mind. And even though we're talking about prophecy here, I want to say you should apply these same questions, these same tests to the preaching of God's word that you listen to, whether it's here in this church or at other churches, especially teaching over the internet. It's one of the reasons why I want to encourage you to bring your own Bibles to church. I'm not just talking about the phony Bible. I know many of you like your phony Bibles, but with a real Bible in front of you, you can actually see the whole passage in its context. You can see a whole chapter in its context, the whole book in its context, rather than just a few words on a screen. You actually learn more of God's word by looking at the Bible physically. And so you must be prepared. That's why I want you to bring a Bible. If you don't have a Bible, then grab one on the table. But bring a Bible, because you must be prepared to match my teaching, any teaching from out the front here, with the Word of God. And apply the basic pub test, if you like. Does it hold true to the Word of God? The very first question, does it line up with the Scriptures? How does it look, or rather, how does it sound against the standard of truth when put side by side with the standard of truth, with your Bible open? Test my word against the word. GBC is, let's be like the Bereans in Acts chapter 17. You know, the Bereans, they received the word that was preached to them by Paul and the apostles. They received with great eagerness. But then they went away and examined the Scriptures to see if these things were really so. Let's be like the Bereans. So on the one hand, do not quench the Holy Spirit. Don't despise prophecy. But on the other, test prophecies, and any preaching for that matter, against the Word of God. Which then leads us to the next command. Look at verse 21b and verse 22. So you can hold fast to what is good, abstain from every form of evil. Or, as I've summarized it on your outline, keep growing in holiness. See, while we wait for God's Son to come from heaven, we are to hear the word of God and we are to obey the word of God, so that we are growing in holiness, so that we grow in Christ-likeness, so that we hold firm to what is good and actually do the good that God requires of us. And at the same time, we run away or we shun worldliness. We turn our back on sin and disobedience, on avoiding every kind of evil. In this verse here, Paul's basically calling us to remember and apply the teachings that he's already given in this letter. And we've done for the last 9 weeks, 10 weeks here at Southside, Gungahlin Bible Church. Here on the screen, this is what we're called to do. Hold fast to what's good, abstain from evil, grow in faith, hope and love. Well, love and hope is the order in chapter 1, verse 3. Keep walking in a manner worthy of God, Paul tells us. Keep hearing and accepting the word of God at work in you and me. Abound in this Philadelphia love for one another more and more. Walk in a manner that pleases God. How do you do that? Well, walk in sexual purity, chapter 4, verses 3 to 8. Walk to work well, if you're a worker, which everyone is, whether you're at home with children or not. Hope in the Lord in this life, and hope in the Lord because of when you die, because of who he is and where he is and what he's done for you. Live as children of the light, children of the day, while we wait patiently for Jesus to return. Grow in our relationships with one another. Remember last week, grow in our relationship with God. Let's keep growing in holiness while we wait for the Lord Jesus to return, or you're going to be with him via your death, whichever comes first. Well, then the last few verses of chapter 5, they actually contrast God's work in us and our work while we wait. So great. Often these paradoxes turn up in the New Testament, that we are to work hard in the Christian life, but God is actually at work in us all the time. Look at the final prayer, verses 23 to 24. While God calls us to grow in sanctification, a fancy word for holiness, growing more like Jesus, once more the reminder is that God is giving us the power to grow. Look at the words that Paul uses in this prayer, verses 23 to 24. Look at your Bible. May the God of peace himself sanctify you completely. May he keep your whole being blameless while you wait for Jesus to return, the final reference to Jesus' return in this book. Because of chapter 4, verse 8, and with your real Bible, you can flick back and see, chapter 4, verse 8, God gives the Holy Spirit to you. Therefore, God will do what he has promised to do. He must do what he has promised to do because he is faithful, chapter 5, verse 24. You see, the perseverance of the saints and the preservation of the saints, of God's people, relies on God's work in and through us by his Holy Spirit. So verses, this always reminds me of a verse that I like quoting, and that is Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, that he, the God who began a good work in you and me on the day he first saved you and me, will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. God works to change us, grow us in Christ's likeness, while we work hard to obey his word. And verses 25 to 27 there, Paul gives us our work to do. Well, in its immediate context, it's really the Thessalonians' work to do, but we're going to apply it to our lives. I've summarized it on the screen in three words, or in your Bible, it's three words: pray, fellowship, and read. Verse 25, brothers and sisters, pray for us. See, Paul knows that he desperately needs, the prayers of God's people to sustain him in the spiritual battle that he faces. By wider application, please keep, if you're part of this church, please keep praying for me, for Adam, for Bob, as we lead this church, as we labour among you, verses 12 and 13. as under shepherds of the great shepherd of the Lord Jesus. Please pray, especially for this week as we have partner meetings. Please come if you're a partner as we labour among you. Please keep praying for us. Verse 26, greet all the brothers and sisters with a holy kiss. I'd love to do just one Bible talk on this, but maybe for another time. But by wider application, the fellowship of God's people is something very special, and we aren't to take it for granted. Perhaps lockdowns reminded us of that. Lockdowns, by the way, that happened this time last year. Don't take for granted this very special, unique opportunity to gather together as God's people. Which rather, it's not really unique, is it? We've been doing it for 2,000 years, but don't take it for granted. Let's greet one another appropriately each Sunday morning. Sometimes we haven't seen each other for the whole week, but we're greeting one another as family members bought by the blood of the Lord Jesus. Remember the Lord's Supper, reminding us of that. We are bought with a precious price, the blood of the Lord Jesus, and we are brought together by grace. So greet one another. And here it says, greet all the brothers and sisters with a holy kiss. For the Latin Americans among us, it probably means a holy kiss, which is a cultural norm for them. For the Asians amongst us here at church, it probably means greet one another with a holy handshake. Or a Korean bow if you're Korean. They don't even touch each other. I don't know how children come about, but greet one another with a holy Korean bow if you're Korean. For the Aussies, maybe it's greet one another with a hearty handshake for the blokes, or maybe even a punch on the shoulder, a gentle punch on the shoulder. For the women, it might be a holy hug for the women. I like to high five the kids, a holy high five for the Bible kids as they arrive at church. Greet all the brothers and sisters with a holy kiss means be aware of cultural norms. Be aware of COVID times as well. Greet all the brothers and sisters with a holy kiss. Be aware as well of the appropriateness of your greeting, especially men toward women, if you're not married to them. 1 Timothy chapter 5 verse 2 reminds us, brothers, so it is speaking specifically to men here, brothers in the church treat younger women as sisters with absolute purity. Let's be a church, a growing church, that rejoices in the amazing grace that draws us together as the family of God in Christ. And so when we come together, let there be genuine warmth, even on a freezing Canberra cold winter's day. Let there be genuine warmth as we come together. Let there be joy displayed because of the Philadelphia love in our hearts, because God's love is there already. Verse 27, I put you under oath, church, before the Lord, have this letter read to all brothers and sisters. By wider application for us, let's keep devoting ourselves to the public reading of Scripture and hearing it as the Word of God, as it truly is. That's why in this church we'll continue to read other parts of the Bible. We're reading at the moment through Genesis 1 to 11. We're not preaching on Genesis 1 to 11, but we're hearing God's Word read on Sunday mornings. The final word comes in verse 28. Look there, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Notice his full title is used again. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with yous. Remember 10 weeks ago, grace begins the letter. It's grace throughout the letter, and now grace ends the letter. Grace. I know we've got a grace or two here, but grace, God's riches at Christ's expense, if you want to remember the word. God's undeserved kindness and favour, lavished, poured out upon you and me. God's love toward us in Christ that we neither deserve nor could ever possibly earn. God's grace that brings forgiveness, as we reminded today through the Lord's Supper. God's grace that brings adoption into his family as brothers and sisters. God's grace that brings new life, that brings eternal life. God's grace overflows in this letter, and it is to overflow into our church life. Chatsworth House there on the screen is one of those remarkable English mansions. Maybe you've been there if you've been to the UK, to Derbyshire. It's the it's probably the scene of many antique roadshows. Apparently it's supposed to be Mr. Darcy's house if you're a Pride and Prejudice fan. At this house, at Chatsworth House, there's a huge cascading fountain that was built in the 1700s. It starts at the top of the hill and goes all the way down a series of steps. And the public in the UK are allowed to walk in this fountain. They're allowed to get in there. It would probably never happen if this was in Australia because of safetyism. I mean, the kids might get wet. They might even have some fun. But here in the UK, you can frolic in the fountain. How good is that? But this fountain is a great reminder, to me at least, of God's grace that continues to flow down upon us, overflowing into your life, overflowing into this church life. It's a reminder that God's grace, his kindness, never stops. Like this fountain, it keeps going because God's love remains firm for all those who turn and serve and wait. Remember, we are to turn from idols, from sin, because of God's grace. We serve the true and living God, motivated by God's grace, and now we're called to wait for the return of the Lord Jesus or your death, resting in his sovereign grace. God's people have always been a waiting people. So, brothers and sisters, let's keep waiting in grace, and let's seek to obey 1 Thessalonians chapters 1 through to 5 for the glory of God. How about we sing our new song together and invite the band up? Thank you.